Are we really forever friends, Ron Woodson?
Forever.
Are we FFs?
We're FF. BFF. Is that what they do? Is that what they say?
BFF. Well, you said forever. Yeah. We're like Romo and Witten.
Yes.
Right? We're BFFs.
Yes, we are.
In that regard. Good to see you, Ron Woodson.
It's good. Hey, man, it is. This place is awesome.
You like it?
Isn't this fun? Nice. This is better than my house. I can live here.
Jeff Garland said that last week. He said he wants to move here. He wants to live here. I wouldn't mind it.
You have some nice TVs. I can watch games here.
We can take one off the wall. I don't know if it's a carry-on item for you to go home back to Northern California or not.
I don't think they'll let me on.
Rod Woodson is here in studio, Hall of Famer. I don't really need to go in your resume. It's you're an all-time great. And you're, as you said, a longtime friend. We probably did more total acts. How many total acts do you think we did? Hundreds, if not 1,000, probably, right?
Yes, we did. We did.
From 05, when did you, and you
started
came
up, I started in 04.
04.
In 04.
Right.
So that's when I started. It was me, you, and Big Link.
And Lincoln Kennedy.
Who's calling games on the sideline for the Raiders remember
Lincoln's chair? We had these tall chairs, right? You and I would sit in these tall wooden chairs. And they had to get one wide,
cast
like an ottoman
iron.
With stilts, and it was cast iron. They needed two.
It was like a 100-pound chair.
They needed two people had to carry
that
it.
That was a heavy chair.
Good old Link.
That was Link.
Back in the day. Do we have a poll question, Chris Brockman, we want to hit to before I start chatting
with you? Yeah, we do. Just real quick, RichEisenShow.com. Royals beat the Giants last night, 10-0.
Game seven
of the World Series tonight.
Yep. Yeah, this is a good one.
Would you rather be the starting pitcher for the home team in Game 7 of the World Series the starting quarterback in the Super Bowl?
Do you want to answer that one, Ron?
Winning pitcher?
It's not determined yet. You have to choose before the event.
Oh, yeah. Okay. That's
going into the game.
Would you rather be a starting quarterback in the Super Bowl or a starting pitcher in a Game 7 of a World Series?
You know, I've played football my whole life. I'm a novice baseball fan. I loved the game last night.
Okay.
I would have to take quarterback in the Super Bowl.
I know.
It's one game. Mm-hmm. It's the best team wins.
Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what the World Series is tonight.
You heard it. Rod Woodson, first time ever, he said he wants to be Trent Dilfer. You just said that. Right there.
Trent's my guy. That's my quarterback.
I know he's your guy. That's my quarterback. I know he's your quarterback. And Elvis, not so much.
Elvis, not so much.
That's a four-letter word to Rod Woodson.
Yeah. He went to Michigan anyway, so that's true.
All right, Mr. Purdue. So what do you make of Romo? Okay, and him coming back in that game. There's a debate going on that should he have a say in coming back in? Shouldn't the doctors essentially say no? But if he's visited Mr. Needle, as he said he did, and that he has nothing structurally wrong with him, the player should have a say. Where do you stand on all of this?
Well, there's protocol for everything in the National Football League. And I think we know if he was concussed, he wouldn't came back in.
Right.
Because an independent doctor would have been there. Mm-hmm. He would have told him no. Listen, if you play long enough in this league, in the National Football League, mm-hmm. you're going to take a needle. That's a given. And you're going to want to play probably when you shouldn't. So, yeah, the tough guys who play long enough, they want to go back in. They want to be a part of the team. They want to help their team win. He didn't come back in and play terrible.
No.
Now, he had the one throw, got knocked down. Whedon came in, played well. I think sometimes a coach has to make a decision, where are we at right now with our football team? I know Romo is our guy.
Right.
But if Whedon is playing well enough, let's keep him in there.
So what about the pressure? What about pressure from your teammates?
I don't think teammates really pressure guys to come back in.
What about the owner? What about an owner who's in the locker room with you? Do you feel that sort of thing? I mean, I'm not saying that this is exactly what happened in Dallas from what it seems to me. It seems that this was all Romo,
right?
And it's just like, if you can go, you should get back in.
And my question would be, did Jerry Jones come back in into the locker room because he was concerned? Because he got hit in the spot that he had surgeries on.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking he came down there more so because he was concerned that was the same spot that he had the surgery on. Not to say, I need you to go back in the game. I don't think he's that callous. I don't think he's that type of man.
No. But sitting, if you're a quarterback like Romo, you're a prideful guy, you want to go back in the game, but you're also thinking, I just took a hit and he had to have whatever MRI tube or whatever x-ray machine he was going into,
right,
being a little bit nervous that I don't know what's going to come back here.
But since he had the surgeries and he knew what it felt like prior to,
mm-hmm.
I think when you're hurt in a certain area and you got hit or something of that nature, you got a feel for where you're at. And I think he understood that, hey, if I take a shot, it'll numb this thing up a little bit, I'll be okay. It's not the same thing as it was before where, got to remember last year, week 17, he couldn't play. And he didn't play. So I think he did the best thing he thought was good for his football team is to come back out there and play football for his team. He's a starting quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys. He normally, and he has played well for him. They just didn't win that game because Colt McCoy.
He was great.
He was slinging that football.
And defensively, where did that Redskins team come from, Rod? Where did that
come
from?
Well, I think that was probably the best pure performance under Jim Haslett. He had a really good game plan. I mean, he gave a lot of different looks. He was putting a lot of people in the line of scrimmage. He had to make the counts with their offensive line and the quarterbacks, and they were dropping guys out, bringing guys late, secondary guys they were bringing. And he was getting hit late sometimes by some of the safeties. But sometimes that happens because the safeties, he's probably 4 or 5 yards back. He's a delayed rusher. As you're scanning the field, you go away, he comes, and it's too late.
And some of the backs just whiffed on some of the protections. They look confused. And this is an offensive line that coming into the game, and even out of the game, some people might say, is the best in the National Football
League. But let's say this. Nobody thought the Dallas Cowboys would be where they're at right now, record-wise. Nobody could have said, I bet my house.
They're 6-2.
They're 6-2. Nobody would have said that. So they're playing good football. Defensively, how Rod Marinelli's got these guys playing that well is amazing. And then the running back, he just has to hold on to the football, for crying out loud. And if he holds on to the football, as a group, he can run the ball.
Yeah, Emmett tweeted out basically like, get down. Because, you know, one of Murray's red zone turnovers was him trying to do too much at the end of a play that he's already done enough. And I'm pleased to say that Emmett Smith's going to join this program tomorrow in our first segment from Charlotte, our first hour from Charlotte. So that'll be interesting. I know you, having worked with you for so long and just knowing you, these defensive penalties that are going through the roof right now have to be driving you nuts. I mean, you take a look at the statistics that we have seen of the defensive calls. We knew it was going to go up based on what we saw in the preseason, but everyone was saying, you know what, this is the preseason. There's a lot of guys who are on the field right now are going to be working at the Home Depot when it's all said and done, a lot of these guys getting cut, and that there's going to be some adjustments that players are adaptable. But illegal contact penalties, we're seeing 59 more this year than at this point through 7 weeks last year. 87 more defensive holding calls, 52 more defensive illegal use of hands call, an offensive pass interference call, one of the 62 being a Steve Smith push-off that was a hugely deciding
play. Come on with that one, though.
And then the defensive penalties that we saw in the game you called this week for Westwood 1, Arizona and Philadelphia were through the roof.
21, I think.
What do you think of all this? I know the answer, but I have to ask
you.
Anyway.
It's hard to watch. Just watching games leading up to calling one every week, you're just seeing so many flags come out. I mean, it was a flag fest in that Eagles-Arizona game. I mean, people like to go to beer fest. Well, if you like to go to flag fest, just go to an NFL game right now, and you're going to see a lot of flags. I mean, they're out. I know they're emphasizing a lot of things, but I think they have to slow down. The one that they called on Steve Smith was just the guy flopped. They should call a penalty on floppers because he flopped. Mm-hmm. Steve did push him a little bit, but you got to man up as a defensive back and make a play on the ball. You can't get pushed down by the receiver. So, you know, I look at these games and just go, man, it's disappointing to watch. And as a fan, the interruption of the game throughout just because flags keep coming out for things that you go back and say, that shouldn't have been called.
But Steve Smith threw the guy down. He threw him down, right?
But this is the way I say it.
Yes.
I'm not going to let a receiver throw me down. That's not happening. I mean, Steve Smith is a strong guy. He's played extremely well for the Baltimore Ravens. As a matter of fact, he's gave him attitude again on the offensive side. They had it when they had Anquan Boldin.
Yeah.
When they had Q, they had some attitude. So he's given them that attitude again.
I think Steve Smith is one of those typical he can play on my team type guys.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. And that's why I don't know what was going on behind the scenes in Carolina, but they got to swallow that and keep him around as far as I'm concerned.
But that right there is that's just unallowable to let a receiver throw you down like that.
But when you take a look at these defensive penalties, though, Rod, this comes from the – we can DNA this thing. It's a CSI, the DNA of all this. It comes from the competition committee getting a call. Jeff Fisher came on this show 2 weeks ago. He was a longtime co-chair of this thing, right? And I asked him where this came from, the competition committee, and he said basically it comes from the clubs. The clubs call the competition committee
what
and
club?
Says, I didn't, he
has. The trainers of the club?
No.
Who?
There has to be, I would imagine it's got to be coaches, right?
It
can't be like team presidents calling up and saying these down-the-field contacts need to be called.
I went to Denver for the training camp, and John Fox was asking questions like the players are asking questions. He was confused about things being called. Jack Del Rio was doing the same thing. The defensive back coaches were doing the same thing. They're trying to figure out why you're calling certain things. I think we all have a problem with if it's 3rd and 25 and I touch a guy in 5.5 yards, you're going to throw a flag and give him a first down. That's an issue. And I think you got to let these guys play. I really don't know if that's really the issue or the case that the clubs are mandating flags being thrown this way. It's like a police officer have a mandate. I got to write so many tickets in a month.
Oh, that happens.
It does happen. Now, I feel like the NFL has a mandate. We got to call 20 penalties a game. Mm-hmm. It's really bad football.
Well, we filled our quota for this segment. Rod Woodson's quota, however, is not even near finished. Rod's going to be with us this entire program. Rod Woodson, Pro Football Hall of Famer, 75th anniversary team member and defacer of my bus.
The Rich Eisen Show, weekdays at noon Eastern. On Audience.